Congresswoman Nancy Mace is joining me now. She represents the 1st Congressional District of South Carolina. Congresswoman, thank you so much for joining me today.
And thank you for having me. Unfortunately, I'm very saddened about the topic that we're discussing today and really and truly heartbroken for our nation.
Yes, well, let's just dive right into what happened at our nation's capital on Wednesday. A lot of us have seen the videos of the unrest and the rioting that was going on outside the Capitol, but you were actually in the building at the time. Can you give us a rundown of what was going on and what was going through your head at that time?
Yeah, a lot of confusion too. I was in the chamber for the joint session initially in the early part of the afternoon. Being a freshman, I said, okay, our first ever joint session, I want to be there and witness this. And Vice President Mike Pence was there presiding over it. And then when that was over, when we recessed to go into separate sessions with both separately in the chambers, the U.S. Senate and the U.S. House, I went back to my office. And at that point in time, Cannon Office Building was being evacuated because there was a threat. And at that juncture, we didn't know what the threat was. And typically, these things are non-factors, they end up not being anything. Unfortunately, there were two pipe bombs, one delivered to the Republican headquarters, one to the Democrat headquarters. Then there was a cooler full of Molotov cocktails that were also found. But when we were coming back to Cannon, our office building, to get back into the office that I'm in today, we got stuck in a tunnel, underground tunnel under the Capitol with about 100 other people waiting to get back because there was some confusion on whether that threat was cleared or not. And then when we were able to come back here to the office with the staff, we were immediately put in lockdown because that was the moment that the rioters breached the Capitol. And five people died that night. I am heartbroken for our nation, and I'm heartbroken for our party. Last Sunday, leading up to this, I was looking at some of the rhetoric that was being spoken online, and my kids were going to stay the whole week. They're in virtual school because of COVID-19. They brought their backpacks with their computers, their notebooks, their schoolwork to start the school year off here. But it'd be kind of cool to hang out in a congressional office, do your virtual school, and roam the halls of Congress. What kid wouldn't want to do that? That's pretty neat. But unfortunately, Sunday night, I said, this doesn't feel right. It doesn't feel comfortable. I am worried. I do fear like that something could go wrong, that there could be violence on Wednesday based on the rhetoric. And on Sunday night, I booked my kids out on the first flight out back home on Monday morning. And I'm so grateful that I did. I could not imagine, I would be devastated if my children had been up here when all of this was happening.
Now, I just want to go back to something you said about, you know, being in your office with your staff, going into lockdown mode. What was that conversation you had with your staff? How did you calm them down? And sort of what was that moment like for you?
Well, we were separated initially, and then we found ourselves a corner office in Longworth on the fifth floor, and we all met up there and sat down and waited until we could get back to Cannon. Then we got stuck in the tunnel together, and so I wanted to make sure that we were together, and I wanted to make sure I knew and was accountable to where each and every person on my staff had been. When we went into lockdown in the office, we had to lock our doors, turn off the lights, and be quiet, and I pulled the shades down, and all you could hear were sirens outside for hours on end in the afternoon going into the evening while all of this was transpiring. I'll never forget the sound of those sirens because they were so loud and went on for so long.
Something I also want to talk about, because I think this might be a perspective that people are not aware of, but when everyone got back into certifying the election results, when sort of the dust started to settle, what was the mood like in that room? And can you give us sort of an insight into how everyone was feeling, the elected officials, about the day's event?
People were certainly worried and concerned. And I think it was split. There were some folks that still wanted to continue to object and debate during this largely ceremonial day. The Electoral College certification process is ceremonial for Congress. It's not a place to debate voter fraud. It's not a place where you can overturn certified election results. That's just not the purpose of it. And so the mood was mixed in the room, but most of us were just really concerned. And I ended up to get to the chamber that night and in the middle of the night to go vote on these issues and certifying the election results. I walked by the crime scene where that young woman was shot and died during all of this. And at that point, we knew there were four people that had passed away. We found out last night there was a fifth. There was an officer in the Capitol Hill police force that passed away. This was a very sad moment in our nation's history. And when you look back at the violence that's been going on all year, just about for 9 months, it's been happening generally with Antifa thugs all across the country in different cities. We saw it in May in Charleston, South Carolina during the King Street riots. This thing has got to end. And as Republicans, this was the first violent event that has happened because of the rhetoric on our far fringes of the far right in our party. We need to recognize that we have a problem and take responsibility for it and come forward with solutions in the weeks and months ahead to put an end to it. And I urge my colleagues in the Democratic Party on the other side of the aisle to also stop with the ramped up rhetoric as well. It's not helping with the fringes on the far left or the far right. Violence will only beget more violence. And what we're seeing today and this week and over the months, last couple of months, particularly the last 8 weeks, but rhetoric has real consequences. People will take those words literally. My life has been threatened over the last couple of days and weeks leading up to all of this. I was accosted outside on a street in DC trying to get supper on Tuesday night. I feared for my children. I sent them home early when this was supposed to be a historic and happy occasion for us this week, and it wasn't. But we need to, as Republicans, be the bigger person, be the bigger party, take responsibility for what has happened so that the American people can start to trust us. We have to earn their trust back. And I look at the lies and the dishonest statements that were made about the Electoral College process. Congress doesn't have the authority or the power to overturn, usurp, or overthrow the Electoral College on Wednesday on that vote. That wasn't ever going to happen because you can't do that via the Constitution. That's what the Constitution says. It's black and white. But also the other big lie that was told, and thankfully Vice President Mike Pence put a stop to it on Wednesday morning, but the Vice President doesn't have the ability to single-handedly overturn the results of the Electoral College either. That's what dictators do. And we're not a dictatorship. We are a constitutional republic. And my pledge, my solemn oath on Sunday was to the Constitution. And every vote that I take, every law that I work on will be with that guiding principle in mind, as it should be for all of us. And so I've taken a strong stand this week. I'm not going to back down. I'm going to do what's right for my kids and for my country because they're worth saving.
President Trump gave a speech on Thursday condemning the rioters, his supporters mm-hmm. that were part of the riots, and said that there would be a peaceful transition of power. What do you make of the president's comments?
I wish they had come earlier in the week, perhaps Tuesday. Hindsight, of course, is 2020. I think that this event, the violence, absolutely could have been prevented. And the president did what was right Thursday night to concede the election and to promise to the American people that this will not happen again and that there will be a peaceful transition of power. That's very important to our country, to every single one of us who are citizens of the United States of America. We can and we should do better.
Is there someone to blame for Wednesday's riots, Wednesday's unrest?
I think there are a lot of people to blame. And when I look at everything that's been talked about and said and ratcheted up, the rhetoric ratcheted up, particularly November 4th forward, that's extremely disturbing to me as a member of Congress and as a parent, as someone who is a citizen of our country. It's just not who we are. And it's really and truly un-American. Our words have real consequences. People will take them literally and take action. It's unfortunate that threats have been thrown about, that there's been violence. And I'm just devastated that 5 people died in all of this when they didn't have to.
I just want to get your take on one last question. Mm-hmm. In a recent interview that you did, you talked about having to rebuild the Republican Party.
I'm distraught. We've got to rebuild our nation and we've got to rebuild our party. This is not who we are.
How are you planning to essentially rebuild the Republican Party? Can you walk us through what you are planning to do?
I'm still working through it. This has not been a lot of time since everything happened, since the rioting and the anarchy transpired on Wednesday, I am starting to think through what that those next steps might be. One, I want to go through my district and listen to people, both those who agree and also disagree with what happened this week and my position on the Electoral College. I think it's very important that we recognize we have two ears and one mouth, and my job is to listen to folks on both sides of the aisle and even those in disagreement within our own party. I do believe the Republican Party needs to be rebuilt, and that starts with recognizing that we have a problem. And within our own Republican conference, I want to be able to bring up these issues and have a conversation about it. Part of the American experiment is to be able to debate ideas and issues as they arise. But the first step that we have to do, and I feel very strongly about this, is to recognize that there is a problem. That's the first step. The second step would be to take responsibility for everything that transpired this week. And I don't particularly want to hear the argument, well, Democrats have been doing this all year and they haven't taken responsibility. Well, we are better than that. And we need to set a better example for the American people. And then work on solutions moving forward to start to earn the trust back of everyone in this country. And I also am going to urge my colleagues in the Democratic Party on the opposite aisle to do the same, because the rhetoric on their side, and we saw some of it this week, there are still very divisive things being said, and it's just got to come to an end. Enough is enough, and I'm going to be vocal about this issue until we do better.
Congresswoman Mace, thank you so much for joining me today to give a perspective of the unrest that went down on Capitol Hill on Wednesday, and I look forward to seeing our country come back together and hope that you can contribute to that as well. So thank you so much for joining me today.
I hope and pray, and thank you so much. God bless our country.